the teacher of teachers. He changed the world for the better and made us better creatures. Oh Allah, we've shamed ourselves, we've strayed from an morning. Surely we've wronged ourselves, what will we say in front of it?
الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون. صدق الله العظيم. We begin with Allah's blessed name. We praise Him and we glorify Him as He ought to be praised and glorified. He who created us all from a drop of sperm, and in whose hand is our life. And we pray for peace and for blessings on all His noble messengers, and in particular on the last of them all, the blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Brother Chairman, our learned and beloved younger brother, the distinguished scholar of Islam, Sheikh Ali Mustafa Simpal, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Before we Surah Al-Hashr of the Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks and He says, O you who believe, be not like those who have forgotten me. And in consequence of forgetting me, they paid the price of forgetting who they are themselves, forgetting their own true nature. And in consequence of forgetting their own true nature, they are taken to a way of life that is sinful. They drown in sin. That sinfulness eventually leads to the corruption of society. The corruption of the society eventually leads to conflict, to acts of violence, to kidnapping. And no amount of police reform bills, neither PNM or UNC, can solve that problem. Now, when you turn away from me, this is where you're going to end up, where we are today in this country. And so welcome, brothers and sisters, to a Muslim response to crime in this country. It cannot be solved, because the chickens are coming home to roost for a people who have turned away from Allah. This is the character not only of Trinidad society, it is the character of society all around the world today. crime is escalating, violence, killing, murder. It is everywhere. It is a universal phenomenon. Can you explain it? Can UWI explain it? Can Whitehall explain it? We say that the Quran and the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, they explain it. And we say that Surah Al-Kahf of the Quran is the surah more than any other, which not only explains to us the strange world in which we live today, but also directs us how to respond to it appropriately and successfully. In order for us to first grapple with the problem in respect of understanding it, we have to speak about two different ways in which people see the world today. It's very strange. There are those who see with one eye, and we don't mean to offend them today, and there are those who see with two eyes. Those who see with one eye, they say, but this is the best world there's ever been. It's never been a better world than this. When we use our measuring rod with which to measure success and progress, we say, well, yesterday we used donkey carts, and today we have the Toyota Camry, that's progress. Today we have aeroplanes, that's progress. Yesterday, to send a message from one place to another, people used to light a fire and put a blanket so the smoke could go up in the sky in a certain way to send messages. Today, we have a telephone. And even more than that, we have something, I don't know whether you see, something called a handphone. And so you're walking down Frederick Street and you see people like this with their hand here, talking. Cell phone. We have instant communication, and that's progress. Yesterday, we used to have to go to the back of the house, to the latrine. To the little latrine inside the house. That's progress. Then there are those who see with two eyes. And they say, no, this is not the best of all worlds. This is the worst of all worlds. It's never been as bad as this. Yesterday, our people knew something that was called modesty. To be modest. Today, they're dancing in the middle of the road naked. That's not progress. Yesterday, the rich and the poor lived together on the same road. And their children used to go to the same school. And so a poor man never felt that his poverty was a curse. But today, the rich now live in their own enclaves. And the poor are relegated to the ghetto. This is not the best of all worlds, this is the worst of all worlds. Yesterday, you could sleep with your window open. Do you remember? If your bed is gray, you will remember. Today, you have to put burglar proof on every window and every door. And you have to have alarm. And some of them have alarm even in the bedroom. That's not progress. Yesterday, we had a people who recognize Allah and who worship Him. Today, all of mankind, illa mashallah, have turned away from Him, have forgotten Him, and we live in an essentially godless world. This is not progress. This is the garbage bin. And every day it grows worse and worse. How can we explain these two ways of looking at the same thing? Dajjal, the false Messiah, the Antichrist, of whom our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam spoke about. So extensively he spoke. And he spoke so powerfully. And we have already spoken on the subject, and the tapes are at the back on the lecture of Dajjal. And you also have the book, Jerusalem in the Quran, which has a chapter on Dajjal. But remember, the most important thing he said about Dajjal, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, is what? Let me remind you. Every prophet has warned his people about Dajjal. And Nuh alayhi salam has warned his people about Dajjal. But I am going to tell you something which none has ever said before me. Dajjal, the Antichrist, sees with the left eye. He's blind in the right eye. It looks like a bulging brick, but your Lord is not one eye. Between his eyes on his forehead is written the word kafir. And every mu'min will be able to read, the mu'min being the one whose Islam is not only on his lips, but is entered into the heart. You know that Islam has entered into the heart when you obey Allah in everything. If Allah says you must perform your salat, then you perform your salat. Now you know, you obey. Every mu'min, that is the one whose Islam is in the heart, every mu'min will be able to read. Whether the mu'min is katib or ghayru katib, whether he's literate, can read and write, or cannot read and write, still be able to read. And we explain this hadith. What it means is that Dajjal sees with only external vision. He's internally blind. The Quran says to us that the heart can see, that the heart can hear, and the heart can understand what reason and the intellect cannot. And so, all those who are embraced by Dajjal, the Antichrist, will be reduced to a state of internal blindness. When you are internally blind, now he can give you a 6 for a 9. And you'll be deceived. The Messenger of Allah said that Dajjal comes with two things. What are they? Two things. What are they? He will come with a river and a fire. The river symbolizing the road to heaven. The fire symbolizing the road to hell. He comes with two things, a river and a fire, but his river is a fire. It looks like the best of all worlds. It is not. It looks like the road to heaven. It is not. It's the road to hell. And his fire is the cool waters of a river. It looks like the fire. It is not. It is the river. It is the road to heaven. He said that whosoever falls in his river will have his load of sins increased. And whosoever falls in his fire, and you will excuse me, of course, to mention Maulana Siddiq Ahmad Nasir, who fell in his fire, and Maulana Imran Hussain, who fell into his fire, you'll excuse me. Whosoever falls into his fire will have his load of sins decreased. Now then, it is when the heart is turned to Allah and there is fear in the heart of Allah that Allah will put nur into the heart and you'll now be able to see what otherwise cannot be seen. But if you exclude Allah from anything, like for example, you take him out of the classroom, it's called secularizing. You take him out of the classroom, so you secularize the educational system. You take him out of the political system, so you secularize the political system. You take him out of the economic life, so you secularize the economic life. You take him out of the male-female relationship, so you secularize marriage and sexual relations. Anytime you take Allah out of anything, He responds by causing you to become internally blind. Musa alayhi salam, and this is a nice story, which leads us to Surah Al-Kahf, which explains why is it that so many people cannot understand what are the causes of crime in this country. Musa alayhi salam is in Sinai after they crossed the Red Sea with Banu Israel. Sinai, the desert, not the hospital in Manhattan. And in Sinai they have to remain for how many years? Allah punished them, they have to stay for 40 years. So during those 40 years, they are moving from place to place. And they had, I don't know whether you've ever seen it, a mobile masjid. What's a mobile masjid? A tent. You fold it and you take it with you wherever you're going. So wherever they stop, they camp, they pitch their tent, and then they have their prayers. Musa alayhi salam will give a khutbah, sermon. So he gave a khutbah. And then one of the Israelites came up to him and said to him, Musa alayhi salam, what a wonderful khutbah. You must be the most learned man in the whole world. Watch out. Anyone tells you that, what must you do? Immediately you must say, praise is due to Allah. Wait a minute, praise is due to Allah. You don't catch me with that. Praise is due to Him. He is al-Alim, the learned, and ilm comes from Him. Wa fawqa kulli zi ilmin alim. And above all the learned is He who is the most learned. But Musa alayhi salam didn't say that. He said, yes, I am the most learned man in the world. Secularizing, taking Allah out. And so he paid the price. He's now internally blind, temporarily, internally blind, he can't see. And then Allah said to him, no, you're not. There's a servant of mine more learned than you are, Musa. He said, I want to meet him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directed him what you have to do to meet him, but you're going to have to read the Surah Al-Kahf to get all those details, and you have to go to the Sahih Bukhari to get the hadith to get these details. I'm not going to give them those details. You have some homework to do. So he met this man, and we are told that his name is Khidr, Green, Mr. Green. Why is he known as Green? The man who is more learned than Musa alayhi salam. The man who is the most learned of all. Why is he given the name Green? will tell you in a moment. So Musa alayhi salam said to him, I want to follow you. But before we give you his answer, Allah describes this man. And he says, وَآتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّ عِلْمًا. We bestowed upon him two things.
Number one,
we gave him knowledge directly from us. So this is not knowledge which is externally acquired. This is knowledge which is internally inspired. And in addition to that knowledge that we gave him, we also gave him rahmah, kindness and compassion. So knowledge which is true knowledge, which is sacred knowledge, that knowledge is always found together with kindness and compassion. It's the same thing with love. When Allah speaks of love in the Quran, He says, وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And we place betwixt their hearts, the man and the woman, love and kindness. So when it is love, I ain't talking about Shabana's market love. I'm talking about the love that comes from Allah. When it is true love, it always has kindness with it. Rahmah. So this man, Khidr alayhi salam, he has this special knowledge that you can't get from reading books. So Musa alayhi salam said, I want to follow you in order that I can learn from you. He replied, he says, إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَسْتَتِيَ مَعَيْ صَبْرًا. No, you won't be able to show patience with me. وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِبْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. And how can you show patience concerning matters which are foreign to your intellect? You have no knowledge about it. Musa alayhi salam said, I promise you I'll show patience. Okay, you can come along with me, but on one condition. What's the condition? Remember, Khidr alayhi salam is talking to a man who just the other day said, I am the most learned man in the world. Khidr alayhi salam said to him, you can come along with me on one condition. And this is very important for the leader to understand. If you want to struggle to build a community of believers that are protected from crime in the world today, this answer is very important. He says, you can come along with me on the condition that you ask no questions until I explain to you. Meaning, until I explain to you that which you are incapable on your own of ever understanding. So he accepted the condition and they went. And then three incidents took place. And we don't have the time to deal with them in detail. Number one, what is number one? The ship. Number two, the boy, and number three, why are you looking at me like that so strangely? It means you're not really reciting Surah Al-Kahf. Number three was? The wall. They went on board a ship. The boatmen knew him, Khidr alayhi salam. They didn't charge them. But while they were on the ship, two things happened. First of all, a little bird came and sat on the edge of the wall of the ship. I don't know what you call it. Sheikh Zayed, what is it called? The bow. And then the little bird flew down, dipped his beak into the water, took some water and came back up. Musa alayhi salam is looking at it. Khidr alayhi salam now teaches him a lesson about knowledge. He says to him, the amount of knowledge that you have and I have combined when compared to Allah's knowledge, is like the amount of water in the beak of that bird when compared with his ocean filled with water. So be humble with your knowledge. Don't boast of being the most learned in the world. Allah is the one who is most learned. And then he did something strange. He took a rod, maybe an iron rod or something, and he broke a hole into the bottom of the boat. It's called scuttling the boat. Musa al-Islam was quite annoyed. You've done something terrible, something wrong. Why did you do this? Wait a minute, you're not supposed to ask any questions. Oh, I'm sorry. I will do it again. They got off the boat and then they met the boy, and Khidr alayhi salam killed the boy. Oh no, 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 no. This is really terrible. This is evil. Why have you killed an innocent boy who has done nothing wrong? And of course he remembered what he had done in Egypt. Remember he killed a man by accident? He suffered a lot for it. Oh no, you're not supposed to ask any questions. Remember that I told you? Innaka lan tastati'a ma'iya sabra. So Musa alayhi salam said, I promise you, if I ask any question after this, you could send me away. And then they kept on traveling until they came to a town. And there they are seeking ta'am, some hospitality. But this town is inhospitable. It would not provide any hospitality, no food, no rest, nothing. Something like Lower Manhattan. Then they found a wall, and the wall was collapsing. And Khidr alayhi salam spent from his own pocket and had the wall rebuilt. Musa alayhi salam sees this, he can't understand. Wait a minute, why don't you at least get some compensation? Law shi'ta latakhazta alayhi ajra. At least you should try to get some compensation for what you spent on it. Why don't you do that? He crossed the line. So Khidr alayhi salam said, Hadha firaqu bayni wa bayni. Hadha firaqu bayni wa bayni. This is the end. This is the parting between me and you. But before I send you away, let me explain to you that which you are incapable of understanding. You see that boat? There is a wicked king who is coming to seize all the boats. I knew it, you did not. And these are poor fishermen. I scuttled the boat so that I could save the boat. Because when the king comes and he sees that this boat is damaging, leave it and go on to the others. And after the king has left, then they can repair the boat. And so what appeared to you to be something wrong and evil, in fact was exactly the opposite. It was something wise and compassionate. And the boy, sometime you plant a seed and you get a rose plant and you praise Allah. It is qurratu a'yun, pleasing to your eyes, that child. Or sometimes you plant a seed and you get a scorpion. Yes. And that child is your ruin. Sleepless nights because of that child. Drugs, robbery, killing, murder, all kind of things. What kind of child is this? He, Musa alayhi salam, looks at the child and can see nothing more than the child. But this this man who is blessed with knowledge directly from Allah, he can see. Allah has given him the knowledge to see that this child is going to grow up to ruin the faith of his parents who are believers. And so I killed the child and pray that Allah will give to them another child who will be better than this one, who would be zakat, something that would be comfort for them. And this wall, beneath this wall, someone had buried a treasure. He was a believer and he was dying. And he was leaving behind two orphan children. And he wanted that this treasure should be preserved for his children so when they grow up they could get it. But again, because it was Lower Manhattan, he couldn't find a single honest man. Not one you could rely on. They're all thieves. So what to do? He dug a hole. He buried the treasure. He built a wall above the hole. And he prayed to Allah to preserve this wealth, and that when his children grew up, to guide them to it. And since the wall was crumbling, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala it was who guided Khidr alayhi salam to go and rebuild the wall to preserve the treasure. In all three of these, appearance and reality were opposite to each other. And the only one whose judgment would be correct would be the one who judges not only on the basis of external observation, but also on the basis of internal, intuitive, spiritual insight, like we used to have long ago in this country. Those of you who are elders would know, we used to have people like that once upon a time, before this age of darkness came upon us. And now this is why he was called Mr. Green. Because he didn't just study books, and books, and books, and cram them, and pass exams, and then spend the rest of his life mechanically transmitting knowledge. When you listen to him once, it's the same thing for the next 60 years. It's the same thing, like a gramophone record. Nothing new. No dynamism. No originality. Nothing which extends the frontiers of knowledge. No. Gramophone records. Not that kind of knowledge. This is a different kind of Maulana here. This is a different kind of scholar here. His knowledge is evergreen. Anywhere that he goes and he preaches, the dead hearts come alive. Anywhere that he goes and he preaches, the knowledge that he reaches out to the people is fresh, like the rain. And so it can stir the heart. It can shake the heart. It can bring tears to the eyes. It can change the lives of people. It can revolutionize a society. This is why he's known as Mr. Green. Someone asked the Messenger of Allah, why is Khidr al-Islam known as Khidr? And the Messenger of Allah replied and he says, once Khidr alayhi salam went to a land which is barren. Barren, nothing growing, like most university campuses today. Nothing growing. And he sat down there, suddenly everything became green. And so he's given the name Khidr. If you wish to understand the world today, if you wish to understand Trinidad and Tobago today, If you wish to understand the phenomenon of spiraling, escalating crime in the society, if you wish to understand a country which is capsizing, and neither the PNM nor the UNC can solve the problem, you have to be able to see with more than external vision and rationality. You have to be able to see with the light of the heart, the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to us. When we are reduced to internal blindness, then Dajjal is ready to take us for a ride, to corrupt us. One of the most important weapons that he has for corrupting us is something called the dunya, the wealth of this dunya. Let me explain to you his strategy. Surah Al-Kahf taught it to me. وَقْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا رَجُلَيْنِ. Tell them the story, says Surah Al-Kahf. Tell them the story about these two men. جَعَلْنَا لِأَحَدِهِمَا جَنَّتَيْنِ مِنْ أَعْنَامٍ وَحَفَفْنَاهُمَا بِنَخْلٍ وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا. Oh, one of them was rich. He had two gardens, and they were very fertile gardens, and they had date palms and corn fields. And the produce was tremendous. وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ. And in between the two gardens, there's a river running through, so natural irrigation. فَقَالَ لِصَاحِبُهُ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِلُهُ أَنَا أَكْثَرُ مِنْكَ مَالًا وَأَعَزُّ نَفَرًا. The rich man talks to his fellow, the other man, who is poor. You say, I'm better than you, because I'm rich. أَنَا أَكْثَرُ مِنْكَ مَالًا وَعَزُّ نَفَرًا. I have more wealth than you, and I also have more people to open my car door anytime I pull up with my car. وَدَخَلَ جَنَّتَهُ وَهُوَ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ. In this state of internal corruption, meaning a rich, and he is convinced that because he is rich, he is a somebody. You heard it? Because he is rich, he is convinced that he is a somebody. And because that fellow poor, he is convinced that he is a nobody. Look at Surah Al-Kahf, explaining to you the cause of crime, one of the causes of spiraling crime. Surah Al-Kahf is teaching you what Whitehall cannot teach you. When he entered into his garden, وَهُوَ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ, in this state of internal corruption, قَالَ مَا أَظُنُّ أَنْ تَبِيدَ هَذِهِ. I don't think that this will ever end. I will be forever rich. وَإِنْ رُدِدْتُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي لَأَجِدَنَّ خَيْرًا مِنْهَا مُنْقَلَبًا. And if, وَلَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمًا. I don't think that this business for the last day will ever come on judgment and so on. But if it does come, and I have to go back to my Lord, he will give me something better than this. I mean, he's really living in fantasy land. His state of internal corruption has caused him to lose touch with reality. What about the poor man? How does does he respond to his poverty? قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ وَهُوَ يُحَارِبُهُ. The poor man now argues with the rich man. أَكَفَرْتَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَكَ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ ثُمَّ سَوَّاكَ رَجُلٌ. How is it that you turn your back on he who created you from a sperm? He who fashioned you into this human being, you turn your back on him. The poor man warns him, listen, I may be poor, but Allah can give me something better than what you have. So his poverty did not corrupt him. He eating dal and roti, but the dal and roti was not a curse for him. No. He is content with the little that he has. It suffices, like it used to once upon a time. And he lives with this hope that if I am content with what my Lord has given to me, I work. I ain't sitting down and doing nothing. No, I work. But if I work, and this is the fruit of my honest labor, then I'm content with what my Lord has given to me. And listen, let me tell you something more. Not only can my Lord give to me something better than what you have, but he can take it away from what you have. He can destroy it. So said, so done. What did Allah do? He withdrew the water, and the gardens were all ruined. No water for irrigation. When the gardens were all ruined, then the rich man is now wringing his hands in frustration. He's wringing his hands in grief and sorrow over his loss. And listen to his words. Ya laytani لَمُشْرِكْ بِرَبِّي أَحَدًا. Woe unto me! Why did I commit this act of shirk? The one sin that Allah will never forgive. Shirk, the worship other than Allah. Where is the shirk? He wasn't worshipping any idol. Oh yes. The shirk was that with his lips he was saying, I worship you. But with his heart, he was worshipping his wealth. How does this explain crying in Trinidad? How does this story of the surah explain the phenomenon of spiraling crying in Trinidad? Answer. When you bring into being a society in which if you are rich, you are somebody. And if you're poor, you're nobody. Then this is what you end up with. This is what you end up with if you have it right now in Trinidad. Why? Well, if I am poor, then that is a curse upon me. Poverty is a curse. No, it is not. Didn't your grandfather teach you that sometimes when Allah wants to punish, He gives you wealth? He says in the Quran, I give them staircases of silver, and I give them roofs of silver, rich, so they're flying high until they're ready for them. It's there in the Quran. So that wealth is a punishment. And sometimes when Allah loves you, He gives you little. And your poverty is good for you. Because Allah knows that if He gave you wealth, the wealth would have corrupted you. And so that poverty is a blessing. But the minute you have a society built on this belief that if you are rich, you are somebody, and if you are poor, you are nobody, then nobody wants to be poor. Nobody wants to be poor. And if I cannot get out of poverty the halal way, I will do it the haram way. No matter what I have to do, I do not want to be poor. Whatever I have to do to get out of poverty, I'm going to do it. So you have this. PNM and UNC cannot solve this. But there is another reason for the escalating crime. Allah is the one who gives. He is Ar-Razzaq. Ar-Razzaq, the one who gives rizq. And when Allah gives, He gives to some more and He gives to others less. But then Allah takes from some and He gives to others. Allah takes from some and He gives to others. How does He take? When you go in the market. When you go in the market, you do business. Whenever you do business, you take a chance. Whenever you take a chance, you take a risk. When you take a risk, you could make a profit. Or you could suffer a loss. That is business, isn't it? From the time you embrace risk, now Allah can take from some and give to others. So one day for me, one day for you. So today he rich, tomorrow he poor. Today he poor, tomorrow he rich. Okay? But when you have an economy like the one you have today, because of banking and insurance, when you have an economy as you have it today, in which the rich are now permanently rich forever and ever and ever and ever, and the poor are permanently poor forever and ever and ever and ever. When wealth no longer circulates through the economy, as it is around the world today, thanks to riba. And you want to ban a man who is teaching the subject of riba. How foolish can you be? May Allah protect us from those who want to stop us from speaking. And may Allah open the eyes of those who are blind. They may see what they are now seeing to do. Ameen. When an economy is based on riba, then wealth will no longer circulate through the economy. And so the rich remain permanently rich and the poor remain permanently poor. I want to say to you today, if you are on minimum wage and you're sitting in this hall, you will remain on minimum wage for the rest of your life. That is the general state of affairs. Those who are trapped in minimum wage will remain there forever. When an economy is based on riba, then wealth will no longer circulate through the economy. Now the rich will remain permanently rich and the poor will remain permanently poor, and that is oppression. Use any yardstick with which to measure, that is oppression. And when a people are oppressed, they eventually respond with acts of violence. They don't care about breaking the law, because the law is protecting the slave master. And so you have kidnappings, and they don't feel that they're doing something very wrong when they kidnap, because we have no other way to change a system of oppression. We are poor, we are on minimum wage, and we will remain on minimum wage forever. And so Surah Al-Kahf is explaining to us the causes of escalating crime. But then there are those who are rich, and they also commit crime. Could they want to get richer? His father owns half of downtown Port of Spain, and yet he takes a flight to London, and the police catch him with 1 kilo of cocaine. But your father don't own half of Port of Spain, man. You're done rich. You want more wealth? Yes. When a society is built on the belief that if you are rich, you are somebody, and you are poor, you are nobody, the one who is the richest of the rich, he is the most important of all. He's at the top of the ladder. And so even the rich will now enter into crime. They will pay the fellow who go and do the murder. The killing is the paymaster. Police will catch that one, they will catch this one. Surah Al-Kahf responds to these as well. Not only to the poor and to the rich. Surah Al-Kahf responds to those whose hearts are now so infected by the dunya. They want more and yet more of the dunya. وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. Tell them that this is the story of the dunya. What? That water falls from the sky. فَاخْتَلَقَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ. And when the water falls from the sky, the greenery emerges and the whole earth is green and flourishing. But then what happens after that? فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا تَزْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ. The green leaves turn to brown. Yes. Everything that you acquire of the dunya will one day turn to dust. The green leaves turn to brown, and eventually everything is blown away by the wind. تَزْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ. Teach them the story of the dunya, says Surah Al-Kahf, and we learnt it when we were children. Do you remember? Dunya se dil laga kar, dunya se kya milega. If you give your heart to the dunya, everything you do from the time you wake up in the morning to the time you sleep in the night is, I want more of the dunya. I live for the dunya. I'll die for the dunya. Everything I do for the dunya. Dunya se kya milega. What does the dunya have to offer to you? Nothing that will remain forever. When you go down into that lonely grave, and if you've never thought before what life is in the grave, do think about it. Nobody there with you. Not your wife, not your children, not your neighbor, not your friend, nobody with you. Everybody turn around and walk away. And they leave you in the grave alone. When you're down there in the grave, you don't take anything from the dunya with you. Dunya se dil laga kar dunya se kya milega. Yaade khuda ki cha tujhko khuda milega. But if you give your heart to Allah, if you give your heart to the guidance which has come from Allah, if you give your heart to the Quran like Sheikh Ali Mustafa, Maulana Siddiq Ahmad Nasir is coming a little later to introduce him. Is Maulana here as yet? Not yet. To introduce him. He was 18 years of age, he was a Christian in Suriname. And you will hear the story of how he became a Muslim. And then Maulana Fadhl Rahman Ansari, rahimahullah, invited him to come and study in Pakistan. And he arrived there in 1969. He and Maulana Siddiq Nasir were in the same class. Same class. I was a senior student to both of them. But when he arrived in 1969, he decided, I want to memorize the whole Quran. compulsory now. And he says, I want to memorize the whole Quran. And guess what? He did it in 1 year. Imran Hussein didn't do it. Wafi Muhammad didn't do it. Siddiq Nasir didn't do it. But Ali Mustafa did it. Hafiz of the Quran. When he goes down in the grave, he takes the whole Quran with him in the grave. That is his companion in the grave, the whole Quran. And so if you give your heart to this dunya, everything I live for is the dunya. The dunya will leave you. وَمَا هَذِهِ حَيَاتُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا لَهْوٍ وَلَعِبٍ. This dunya and the life of this dunya is only sport and entertainment and amusement. وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. But that is the permanent life, if only they could understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانٍ. Everything will perish and pass away. Everything. وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. And only the face of your Lord, fair and magnificent, will remain. And in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah speaks again about the end. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا. We have placed all of this in the earth to be its beauty, its ornament, in order to test you. وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. But one day, we reduce everything to dust. It will become a dust bowl, this earth. And so Surah Al-Kahf tells us how to get out of the situation in which we are in respect of crime. Do not give your heart to the dunya. Give your heart to Allah. But Surah Al-Kahf tells us even more. To explain the crime that we have escalating around the world. And then finally, Surah Al-Kahf tells us how to respond. Let us explain this and then we'll end, inshallah. Dhulqarnain, remember last lecture? He has faith and Allah has given to him power. So he is the controlling power in the world. When power rests on the foundations of faith, this is the last lecture, we have the tape in the back, Gog and Magog lecture. When power rests on the foundations of faith, Surah Al-Kahf explains how is power used. Dhulqarnain says, I will use my power to punish the oppressor. Or when he goes to you, you will punish him as well. So there will be harmony between this world and that. Dhulqarnain says, I'll use my power to help those who have faith and whose conduct is righteous. Treat them nicely. And then Dhulqarnain traveled in the opposite direction. And there he came across a people who had nothing. Nothing. Only the clothes on their backs. You have a book in front of you, the Islamic Travelogue. You will see in that the part of the travelogue where I went to Bangladesh. And then in Bangladesh I traveled all the way down to the south to the sea. And when I came to the seashore, I saw the seashore full of people. They're all refugees, Muslim refugees from Burma. And they lived off the sea. They had nothing. Nothing. Dhulqarnain had the compassion, the good sense, the wisdom, not to inflict any damage on these people. And then Dhulqarnain traveled in the third direction, to the pass between the two mountains. And there he came across a people layakaduna yafqahuna qawla. Couldn't understand their language. But we covered this in the last lecture already. And then these people said to him, inna ya'juja wa ma'juja mufsiduna fil ard. These two people, Gog and Magog, they are committing fasad. They are corrupting our earth. This is what we have in Trinidad. This is what we are facing here today, something called fasad, the corruption of the society. Can you help us, O Zulkarnain? Can you build a barrier? Can you build a barrier between us and them to protect us from them? Are you seeing now the answer? Are you understanding the answer? How to respond to a society which is plagued with violence and crime and murder? Can you see the answer? They said, can you build a barrier to protect us from them, that they cannot reach us? You see the answer now? That they cannot reach us. If you build the barrier, we will be prepared to pay. Yeah, I don't need your money. What Allah has given to you is more important, more valuable. Bring for me blocks of iron. And he built a barrier with blocks of iron. And remember, the Quran tells us that iron is a metal which did not form part of the original constitution of the earth. وَأَنْزَلْنَا الْحَدِيدِ And we sent down iron. And to which Maulana Ansari responds and says, this probably means that iron came down from an extraterrestrial source, like a meteorite. And so what you need to build a barrier is not something which belongs to this world. If you are to build a barrier to protect yourself from that wicked world, you need something which comes from another world to build a barrier. Are you following me? So he built the barrier. And then he put molten copper. And when he had done that, now Gog and Magog could neither penetrate nor could they scale the barrier. But then came that day when the Prophet ﷺ informed us that Allah has now brought down the barrier. Remember? He raised his hands like this. He had a dream. He said, today Allah has made a hole in the barrier. And so Gog and Magog were released in the lifetime of Nabi Muhammad ﷺ. When Gog and Magog are released, the people who are going to suffer the most are who? In the prisons of Abu Ghraib, the Arab. Because the statement was, Wailul lil Arab, woe unto the Arabs. When Gog and Magog are released, they will eventually spread out in all directions. And they take control of the world, in the world order of Gog and Magog, and then they proceed to use their power to oppress. This is Suratul Kahf of the Quran teaching you, explaining to you the world in which you live today. Why will you not go to the Quran? Seek Allah's forgiveness for having neglected the Quran. And now go to the Quran, and the Quran might explain to you the strange world in which you live today. Power will now be used to oppress. The opposite of Zulkarnain. Power will now be used to wage war on those who follow the religious way of life, who have piety, who are righteous and honest. If he's a Hindu, he'll still wage war on him because he's a pious Hindu. If he's a Christian, he'll still wage war on him because he's a man of piety and righteousness. But the Muslim, he's the one who will face the brunt of the war. So the war on Islam, which is taking place in the world today, is explained in Surah Al-Kahf. And then, there are those who have nothing. Nothing. Except the clothes on their backs. And even those who have nothing, even they, this wicked world order will attack them. and take from them the little that they have. This is what is happening in Haiti today. And Haiti is around the corner, so you cannot say you did not know. Haiti is one of the poorest places on the face of the earth today. And Haiti is not poor by accident. The reason why Haiti is the poorest place in the world today is because 200 years ago, Haiti slapped them on their faces. 200 years ago, a powerful slap on their faces. They've never forgiven Haiti for that. And so for 200 years now, they've been punishing Haiti, and they're still punishing Haiti. A people who have nothing, and yet you're attacking them and taking from them even the little that they have. Zulkarnain was the opposite of that. Can we recognize these Gog and Magog people? Who are they? Last month, we turned to Surah Al-Anbiya, and we turn to two verses of Surah Al-Anbiya where Allah speaks about a town. Remember? He destroyed the town. Remember? He expelled the people of the town. Remember? And then he banned them from ever returning to reclaim that town as their own. Do you remember? And then he said that these people will return to reclaim their town when? When Gog and Magog were released and they spread out in all directions, then you will see this amazing spectacle of these people who were expelled from that town by Allah, banned from ever returning to reclaim the town as their own. You will see it before your eyes. You will see these people returning to reclaim that town as their own. Which town is it? وَحَرَامٌ عَلَىٰ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا أَنَّهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ حَتَّى إِذَا فُتِحَتْ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ حَلَبٍ يَنْسِلُونَ. We said, the town of Jerusalem. Remember? Sheikh Ali Mustafa agrees with me. Yes. The town of Jerusalem. So when you see the Jews returning to reclaim the holy land as their own, as they have done, then the Quran is saying to you that those who have made possible the return of the Jews to the holy land, namely the world order which controls the world today, in which Washington is the leader, that's Gog and Magog. That's the world order of Gog and Magog. The Quran is saying that to you. So you know who you have to protect yourself from. Huh? You should be seeking to protect yourselves from them. If you will forgive me for reminding one more time, we should not be seeking to worship at the altar of a US visa. No. We should be seeking to protect ourselves from that. Now, what did Maulana Fadhlur Rahman Ansari, rahimahullah, have to say on that subject? When I was here last month, I referred to this book, Gog and Magog and the State of Israel. But I was referring to an earlier edition. And I said in my remarks that from what was written in this book, it appears clear that Maulana Ansari also held the view that the town was Jerusalem. But I went back home and I got this copy, which is from Maulana Ansari's library. I have been blessed by being given the entire library that he had. I have it with me. And this is a later edition. And I want to read to you what this man says. He begins the book by saying that the town is Jerusalem. That's the most important point he makes in the whole book. And now listen to what he says about Maulana Ansari. At the end, I must acknowledge my most sincere thanks to Maulana Fadhlur Rahman Ansari, whose interpretation an explanation of the verse relating to the return of the people to the city which was destroyed, referred to in the preceding pages, inspired me to make research and to write on this subject. Now it's plain and plain. Maulana Fadhlur Rahman Ansari Rahimahullah, he also held the view that the Tower of Jerusalem. And so now we know the corruption of our society, the escalating crime of our society, the murders, the anarchy, the mayhem, the kidnapping, these things are not happening by accident. This is part of the corruption of the world by God and Maga. Now we know, no one can solve that. No one. Now we know, police reform bill or no police reform bill is going to get worse and yet worse. The Messenger of Allah said, he climbed to the roof of a house and he looked out. This is Medina. He said, I see harsh falling on your rooftops like raindrops. I see harsh falsing on your rooftops like raindrops. So they asked, O Messenger of Allah, what is harsh? He says, killing and slaughter, murder. And so he anticipated what we are having here today. It cannot be solved. Stop. Because this is God and Allah. Well then, what should we do? Let us tell you that and we'll end the lecture. How do we respond to it today, which is already so dangerous, and to a tomorrow which is going to be worse than today? What should we do? What does the Quran tell us? I leave behind me two things. So long as you hold on to them, you will never go astray. The Book of Allah and my Sunnah. It's not enough to preach and preach and preach. You heard enough lectures already. When will we put it into practice? When will we create a living model of Islam? The Quran and the Sunnah. So we can invite Port of Spain, come and see, this is Islam. The solution lies in building a barrier between you and that world of crime. That's the first solution. The second solution is that when you build that barrier, you have to build that barrier with that which comes from another world, like I am. And that which came from another world is the Quran. And he who lived the Quran, the Sunnah. That's the solution. They have no other solution. You could climb the highest mountain, you will never find another solution. This is the only one. Suratul Kahf is telling you the solution. We have to come together, all of us. Whether you stand up for Ta'zim or you don't stand up for Ta'zim is irrelevant. Don't come to me to argue on those issues because I am not going to be a part of them. It is irrelevant. We have to come together as a people who will try to establish a society based on the Quran and the Sunnah. And when we build that community, we have to ensure that that community is disconnected from the world of crime that is escalating out there. This is the project of the Muslim Village. This is going to be our subject for the next lecture, inshallah. Establishing a Muslim village in the island of Trinidad. this Muslim village comes out of Surah Al-Kahf. I say to you that the 1950s and 1960s were an exciting time to be in Trinidad, when we were little children. And Haji Zainul Khan, the president of the TIA, Jama'atul Taqwiyatul Islam, who is sitting in the back there, he was already a young man. And Dr. Wahid Ali will be here with us next Sunday, inshallah. They will tell you, the 50s and the 60s were an exciting time to be a Muslim in this country, when the people of African origin were now entering into Islam. And we didn't have a parting of ways as yet. And I now say to you that if we can establish this Muslim village in Trinidad, we'll welcome another exciting time in our history. And one more time you can go to sleep with your window open, and your wife can walk anywhere in the village, anytime, day or night, and she'll be safe. We will do in this village what the government cannot do, what NHC cannot do. We'll establish a social order, a society, a community, living by the divine guidance, which will be stable, which will be healthy, which will be peaceful, and which will be free from crime. This is the challenge. And I invite you, brothers and sisters, to join with me next lecture, inshallah, when we will explain to you and present to you the project of the Muslim village in Trinidad. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين آمين.
We once had a teacher, the teacher of teachers. He changed the world for the better and made us better creatures. Oh Allah, we've shamed ourselves, we've strayed from Al-Mu'allim. Surely we've wronged ourselves, what will we say in front of him? He was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad, mercy upon mankind. He was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad, mercy upon mankind, teacher of all mankind. Aba al-Qasim, ya Habibi, ya Muhammad, ya Shafi'i, ya Muhammad, khayru khalqillahi Muhammad.
Ya Mustafa, ya Imam al-Mursalina, ya Mustafa, ya Shafi'a al-Alamina, ya Mustafa, ya Imam al-Mursalina, ya Mustafa, ya Shafi'a al-Alamina, ya Mustafa, ya Imam al-Mursalina, ya Mustafa, ya Shafi'a al-Alamina.
He prayed while others slept, while others ate, he'd fast. While they would laugh, he wept, until he breathed his last. His only wish was for us to be among the ones who prosper. Ya Mu'allim, peace be upon you, truly you are our teacher. Mu'allim.